the two, you know, two culture at the same time.
Now, we've talked about this on the show before, right? We've got...
Welcome to The Ordinary Show. I'm your host, Cheryl Brown, and today we have with us a special guest, Dr. Harris, and we're going to bring him on now to talk to him about some exciting things. Let's welcome Dr. Harris. Welcome.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us today, and today we're going to talk about you, an ordinary person, doing extraordinary things, and I'm sure the audience can't wait to find out what exactly is extraordinary about you. So we're going to look at the audience and tell them a little bit about your experience growing up in Boston. You're from here?
Yeah, I was born and raised in the Roxbury section of Boston, and I worked for the last 4 years in K-12 schools in Boston. I'm presently the superintendent and chief executive officer of the Boston Renaissance Charter Public School.
So what has been some of the better experiences of growing up in the Boston area?
I feel blessed growing up in Boston. I grew up in a single parent home, but there were men in the community who guided me, gave me inspiration, who coached me. I feel fortunate to have had certain people in my life at certain times.
And what were some of the challenges? I'm sure you have lots of memories, good and bad, about the area. I'm new to the area.
Boston was a very segregated city, and my family didn't have a lot of money. And as I mentioned, I grew up in a single parent home. And so I thought that my ticket out in order for me to change my condition would be to play football. And so I thought that I would go to high school, play high school football, and go to college and become a professional football player. But it didn't work.
Okay. You played in high school?
No, I didn't. That's why it didn't work.
Oh.
That's why it didn't work.
Okay.
When I got to high school, I was real skinny, and so the coach didn't give me a uniform. He didn't let me play, and so all my dreams of going to college went out the window. And so, you know, I was not motivated, and so, you know, I had a difficult time in high school and wanted to leave, but my mother insisted that I stay there, and I did. And when I graduated, I joined the Marine Corps.
Okay.
And volunteered to go to Vietnam.
Okay, yeah, my memory, if it's serving me, you left for the military before you had the opportunity to go to college.
Yes, I joined the Marine Corps, volunteered to go to Vietnam, and then when I was in Vietnam, I read about the first black quarterback at a white school in the South. And I'm in Vietnam reading about this black quarterback at a white university in the South.
Wow.
In 1967, and And that was unheard of. I mean, black, white universities didn't want black people in their schools, and to have a black quarterback, the head of the leader of the team, was extraordinary. And I was reading about this guy, and it turns out he had the same name as the quarterback on my team in Roxbury when I grew up. And I wrote him a letter and asked him, is this the same? Is this Freddie Summers from Boston? And he wrote me back and said, yes, he was the quarterback at Wake Forest University in North Carolina.
Oh, my goodness.
He wrote me back and told me that it was him, and that if I was there, you know, I would be starting running back. He said, you're better than all the guys on this team.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, and I'm in Vietnam. And so my whole attitude about dying in Vietnam, you know, killing and dying chains, and I wanted to come home.
Yeah, that was interesting that you volunteered to go to Vietnam.
Yeah.
That was interesting.
Well, it was a viable job option.
Oh, okay. So, okay.
I had no other options.
Okay.
You know?
That's definitely understandable. So all of those circumstances led to why you decided to go into the education profession?
No, what happened, I was with a unit in Vietnam that was sustained a lot of losses. You know, a lot of folks died and were wounded, and I thought I was going to die. And as I mentioned, I wanted to return and I wanted to play football. I had a daughter that was born while I was in Vietnam.
Excuse me.
And I promised God that, I made promises to God that if I lived, that I would work. I would dedicate my life to working with kids like me, like myself. And so, as you can see, I made it back. And so for the last 40 years, I've been working with youth in public schools in Boston. I've been a school teacher, I've been a football, basketball, track coach. I've been dean of students, assistant headmaster, and superintendent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So 40 years in education.
Mm-hmm.
And you're currently with Boston.
The Boston Renaissance Charter Public School.
Tell us a little bit about Boston. I'm sure you have some proud moments that you want to share with us.
About the school?
About the school.
The school is an incredible place, incredibly dedicated teachers. It's the largest elementary school in the city of Boston. We educate 944 students. We have a rigorous academic curriculum. We have an enrichment or specialty curriculum that's unmatched by any school in the city. Our kids are learning to read and write music. They're learning to play piano. They're learning to play violin. We have dance studios. They're learning 5 and 6 forms of dance. We have art studios. Our students are learning to understand, speak, and write Mandarin. It's an incredible school.
Yeah.
And we're a level one school. You know, we have a dental center at the school. We have a vision center at the school. We have a health center at the school. So we take pride in educating the whole child. We try to meet the needs all the needs of children. And so we try to remove the obstacles to learning and make it easier for parents,
mm-hmm.
you know, so that parents don't have to take time out of their busy schedules to take their son or daughter to the dentist or to the optometrist. Mm-hmm. You know, you can do it right in one stop.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
One of the stories that struck me as fascinating was your visit to China, and you were talking about the level of concentration and self-discipline that you observed in the students there,
mm-hmm.
and it reminded you. So just take a moment and tell us about your experience there.
We started a Mandarin program 5 years ago. We piloted the program with 88 kindergarten students. Since then, we've received a $1.3 million grant from the federal government to expand the program, and so now over 700 students at Renaissance are taking Mandarin and learning to speak, understand, and write Mandarin. And so we've been going back and forth to China.
Mm-hmm.
We've been to China, I think, 9 times in the last 3 years, maybe to 10 different cities, maybe 47 schools. And almost every school that we've visited, the level of student engagement has been so impressive. They have 45 or 50 students in a classroom, one teacher. Students are motivated, highly motivated. They're given responsibilities. They monitor themselves. And they take pride in wanting to be the best in the world. And so we're planning to take students to China this year because I want American students to see you know, what's happening around the world. I want our students to realize that they're citizens of a global community.
Exactly.
And they need to. American kids are competitive. And right now, you know, they see basketball, football players, baseball players, you know, the rappers, you know, and so they aspire to be those things. But I want them to see what other students on the other side of the world are doing and how motivated they are. And I think that by visiting China, some of our students will be motivated as well.
So the school systems in China, are they generally public across the board, or do they have private schools and public schools?
Well, they have private schools, but I visit public schools, and they have a national curriculum, and so, you know, all the schools are expected to learn, you know, the same curriculum, no matter what city you go to.
Mm-hmm.
So it's unlike in America, it's a national curriculum that's basically administered by the government. This Common Core is trying to lean that way.
Yes.
You know, but yeah, it's interesting.
What are your thoughts on Common Core?
I appreciate standardized testing, whether it's MCAS or Common Core. I understand the need to have a system for assessing schools, but I think, you know, whether it's Common Core, whether it's MCAS, you know, that's just one measure. And Common Core and MCAS, neither measures all the things that educators need to do for students. And so, you know, in its context, I think it's a useful tool.
Mm-hmm.
But there are so many other things that need to be offered for children and that can and should be measured when you're measuring the success of a school.
And I'm sure the schools in China are effective as a result of a combination of government, standardized education, and the culture.
Yes, yeah. But it's interesting, the Chinese folks are eager to learn from us because, you know, their students are very regimented and they do very well in science and math. But they don't question teachers, and they look at our students, and our students are more creative. And so what China is trying to do is find a balance.
Okay, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that was going to be my next question. Like, what would be a takeaway that you think that we could add value to their system and mm-hmm. vice versa?
Mm-hmm.
And that makes perfectly good sense,
mm-hmm.
the creativity. So what do you think about the push towards increasing or improving STEM education in America, in that it seems like we lag behind in science, technology, engineering, and math?
Well, we do. We do. I mean, if you think about it, the majority of elementary school teachers are women. And historically in this country, women have been discouraged from taking math and sciences. Yet they're expected to teach math and science to
exactly.
elementary students. And so most elementary school curriculum they don't spend much time on science. Or math. And so I think that the push to elevate science, technology, engineering, and math is important. And I think it's very important for us to recognize the fact that we need to get women more involved. And so at Renaissance, we have a STEM curriculum, but we're also interested in planning to build a new science, technology, engineering, and arts and math, build STEAM. We're taking STEM to STEAM. We're going to build a new wing on the school in the next couple of years, yeah, which will have a STEAM focus.
Excellent. Yeah. Okay. How long has the Boston Renaissance School been
in existence? We've been in existence for 20 years, but we were located in downtown Boston in a 15-story high-rise. And 5 years ago, we sold that building. We bought a 6-acre site, and we built a brand new
campus. Oh,
yeah.
I got a chance to visit this week, and it is beautiful.
Thank you.
I'm not sure which annual
First Ladies
breakfast
yes.
Was outstanding. What
we have,
number was the 12th or?
No, that was the, fifth annual. First Ladies Breakfast. So we have mentoring programs. We started a mentoring program for boys because black and Latino boys all across this country they're the lowest performing students on any standardized test.
Oh.
And so we wanted to focus on our boys. And so we started a mentoring program. We used music to attract them. And then we mentored them about moving from boyhood to manhood and the importance of respecting yourself, respecting women, respecting authority. And the girls came to us and said, if you're going to do anything for the boys, you got to do it for us too.
Exactly.
And they name themselves the First Ladies, and so we have a mentoring program for girls, and we have an annual First Ladies Mentoring Breakfast, and thank you for coming and joining us and mentoring one of our students. We have about 85 women annually who come over and spend time with our girls, and these are some of the most powerful, influential, inspiring women in and around the Boston area.
It was certainly outstanding. Thank you for inviting me. So with the boys, has their event passed, or is that upcoming?
The boys' event is hosted in October, and the boys are called the Young Kings, and we do a similar thing to what you experienced. We have about 100 men who come in. And mentor the boys. So that was held in October.
Okay.
Yeah. So we do the girls in March, because it's March is Women's History Month.
Okay.
We try to collaborate with a tribute to women.
Excellent. If you were to have a moment to speak to the young people, the purpose of this show is ordinary people doing extraordinary things. So most of the time when you have people that are extraordinary, they're not boastful, they're very humble, so you don't hear about the wonderful things that they're doing after hours. Like, you're the CEO and superintendent of the school, you've been in education for 40 years. So a lot of times on television, you have what you see as reality TV. Mm-hmm. So the purpose of this show is to give true reality.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say to the young people as three most important things that they should be concerned about now? It's a lot of things in the news, it's overwhelming, but three points of focus if you were to speak to young females first, and young males second.
Young people need to think about their future. They need to forecast where they want to be 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now. And it doesn't matter, and this is for boys and girls, it doesn't matter who your parents are, who your parents were, how successful they are, how unsuccessful they are, how educated they are. As I mentioned, I grew up in a single parent home with my mother and my grandmother. Neither one went to college. I now have a PhD. When I was in high school, I had teachers tell me that I wasn't college material, that I should transfer and go to trade school and learn to use my hands. As I mentioned, I have a PhD now. 15 years after teachers were telling me in high school that I wasn't college material, two of them were working for me. You know, and so it doesn't matter what anybody might say, and it doesn't matter what anybody might think. You have to be determined that you want to be successful. If you want to change your condition, you have to work hard. You have to be like a sponge and try to learn as much as you can from as many people as you can. There are always going to be negative influences around you. And I think students, kids today, you know, they're bombarded with negative images. They have to stay positive, and they have to look for positive people, try to surround themselves with positive people. And if they do that, they'll be successful. And it doesn't matter where you live. Doesn't matter, you know, what school you attend. You know, you have to want to be successful, and don't let anyone discourage you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when you see documentaries or news, historical reports about how economy affects where you go in life, and how some people never move outside of their neighborhoods, they've never traveled outside of their neighborhoods, or they don't have access to resources. So all of those economic circumstances, advantages, disadvantages, they play a part, but they don't necessarily have to determine your future. Anybody could overcome that, is what you're saying.
That's what I believe. That's what I believe. And I think back to my own life. You know, I was running with a group of guys, and we were doing negative things. And there was a man in the neighborhood who organized us. And he started us playing football, organized football, basketball, track and field. He was the one that inspired me and made me think that I could go to college. It didn't work out when I got to high school. And then in Vietnam, you know, Freddie Summers made me realize that I could and should be in college. He was there, and he says, you should be here too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so different people come into your life at different times, and some people have more advantages than others, but you have to be determined, you have to want to be successful, you have to you have to set goals for yourself and work hard to achieve those goals. And if you work hard to achieve your goals, you will. And life isn't easy. It sounds real easy to say work hard and you achieve your goals, but life knocks you down, but you got to keep getting back up. Everybody gets knocked down, but everybody doesn't get back up.
That's the key. You know? That's exactly true. So set goals. How young is it? Is there any age that's too young to start setting some goals?
I don't think so. You know, at Renaissance, we're K through six, and so we start at kindergarten, and we let kids know that you need to be thinking about your future. We take kids over to Harvard. Professor Ogletree annually has our students come over to Harvard.
Wonderful man.
And sit in the law school.
Yes.
They sit in the same seats that President Obama sat in. And they listen to him. He was President Obama's professor. And so they sit in the seats. They walk the same corridors that President Obama had. They listen to the professor that President Obama had. And he tells them that Harvard University is your school. And not only do we want you here as students, we want you to come back here as professors. And so they see it, they feel it, they smell it, they taste it, so Harvard becomes a reality.
Yes, yes.
You know? And so, and that's what I think needs to happen for economically disadvantaged kids. They need to be exposed to things other than sports.
Exactly.
And when they are, they'll achieve.
Outstanding. Oh my God. Professor Ogletree is, he's just a gem.
He is.
So down to earth.
He is.
Very inspiring. What other questions did I want to ask you? Do you have anything that you would like?
I need to add that I attended Boston University.
Okay.
I played football for Boston University, and now I'm a professor at Boston University. And so we're trying to open doors for kids from the inner city to come to Boston University.
Mm-hmm. Having a life plan is something important for young people to keep in mind. Stay motivated. Sometimes when you don't have encouragement, encourage yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Keep a positive attitude. And I'm sure stay away from as much negativity as possible
And I have a strategy for that. When something happens, because we all have to make decisions. So when something happens, when you have to make a decision, every young person should hesitate 4 to 5 seconds and ask themselves this question. What would my mother or my father or whoever it is that's taking care of me, what would they think if I do this? And if that little voice comes back and says they wouldn't like it, you shouldn't do it. If it's something that your parents or the people, your caregivers, wouldn't like, don't do it.
And wow. You need to emphasize that.
I'll say it again.
Because there's an epidemic in Massachusetts right now with heroin.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very sad state of affairs, but if people were to implement just that little strategy there, mm-hmm. it could sometimes veer them in another direction as far as mm-hmm. having a strategy for staying away from negativity,
yeah.
because negativity is all around us all the time. Say that again.
Too many of us suffer from low self-esteem, and when you suffer from low self-esteem, you're subjected to making bad decisions, whether it's somebody daring you to do something, or whether it's somebody offering you something, whether it's a drink or a smoke, or a pill, you know. And so what kids do sometimes is to be accepted, you know, they'll go along, you know, to get along. And so what I tell young people is if someone says, I dare you to do something, that should be a red flag. As soon as you hear, I dare you, you should realize that that person thinks that they're smarter than you are, and they're trying to get you to do something that they wouldn't do. So
mm-hmm.
as soon as you hear, I dare, then the light should turn on in your head, and you should know that you shouldn't do it,
mm-hmm.
you know? And then the other thing is, you don't have to impress anyone. You don't have to impress anyone, and you don't have to go along to get along. And so, again, if you take 4 to 5 seconds when you have to make a decision to stop and think, and then ask yourself, what would my mother, what would my father think about this decision? And if the voice that comes back, the answer that you hear is, my father wouldn't like it, my mother wouldn't like it, my grandmother wouldn't like it, my grandfather wouldn't like it, don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't matter what your peers are saying, because your peers aren't the ones that are taking care of you.
Exactly.
The people who are paying the rent, paying the bills, buying your clothes, buying the food, those are the only people you need to impress.
Mm. Exactly. And again, this show is geared mainly for people, younger people, in that we want them to understand that being successful and extraordinary is an evolutionary process. You evolve. You're just not magically successful one day. Wake up successful. You come through a process. And as a younger person, what helped me in deciding how I wanted my life to be is I would take a moment and say, how would I feel about this decision 5 years down the road? Mm-hmm. Would I still be proud that I have done this action? And that has kept me from making a few bad decisions when I employed that. How would I feel about this later in my life?
We tell boys, whether they're little boys or whether they're teenagers, we tell them to treat girls and to treat women the same way you would want somebody to treat your sister or your mother. You know, don't say anything to a girl or to a woman that you wouldn't want said to your sister or to your mother. You know, so that's another little strategy for the boys out there, you know. Treat girls the way you want somebody to treat your mother or your sister.
Definitely. Any other thing you would like to add or share that interesting we don't know about you?
I appreciate being invited to the show. I never think of myself as extraordinary. I think of myself as being blessed. I've been real fortunate. You know, I've had some hard times. But, you know, I've had so many blessings. You know, I've been... It's interesting, you know, having struggled the way I did in high school, and then end up being Massachusetts Principal of the Year. I was a National Distinguished Principal. I've been invited to the White House 5 times.
Wow.
When I was a teenager, folks thought that I would never go to college. You know, so I've been able to do all these things, but it's been because different people came into my life, and because I did want something better, you know. And so I appreciate you having me on the show. But what I tell young people, if I can do it, you can do it, because you have more than what I have. You know, you have me and the whole. Here it's-